My name is Bond.
James Bond.
James Bond.
James Bond. James.
Good evening, 007.
Sexist, misogynist, dinosaur.
Ready to save the world again?
Charming, sophisticated secret agent. Shaken, but not disturbed.
Like boys with toys.
No more foreplay.
British secret agent James Bond 007 is on a secret mission in Cold War Soviet Russia, along with friend and fellow 00, Alec Trevelyan. Things start to go wrong, and Trevelyan is murdered at the hands of General Urumov. But James Bond is able to complete the mission and make a high-flying escape. 9 years later, James Bond is in Monte Carlo, where he undergoes a little evaluation, some high-speed driving, where he makes contact with Xenia Onatopp, who enjoys baccarat and pulling rank. Bond continues his investigation and uncovers a dead admiral. Bond gives pursuit, but he's too late, as Xenia makes off with a high-tech stealth helicopter. Meanwhile, at a space weapons control center in Severnaya, Russia, we meet computer programmers Natalia Semyonova and Boris Grishenko. Xenia and General Urumov arrive at the command center, where the two murder everyone at the base. The two use the technology to reprogram one of the satellites and steal the Goldeneye device before making their escape. But they left one survivor behind, Natalia Semyonova, but the satellite fires its weapon upon the command center with Natalia inside. But Natalia manages to escape. James Bond meets with the new M, who sends Bond to St. Petersburg, Russia to investigate. Bond meets his new contact, Jack Wade, from the CIA, who brings Bond to meet Valentin Zhukovsky. And after some tense negotiations, Bond convinces Zhukovsky to make an introduction. Back at the hotel spa, Bond rendezvous once again with Xenia, and with a little persuasion, Bond gets Xenia to introduce him to Yanis, who ends up having a very familiar face, and it's revealed that Yanis is really Alec Trevelyan, who faked his own death. Bond, along with Natalia, manage to escape death by sabotage, but are taken in by the Russians. The two are interrogated, but it's cut short by General Urumov, but Bond and Natalia make their escape. The two get separated, Natalia is taken away by Urumov, but Bond is in pursuit. And after a drive through St. Petersburg, James Bond heads them off at the pass, and Bond manages to derail the train. James Bond negotiates for Natalia, but he's forced to make a choice. Bond and Natalia escape the train in the nick of time, and then the two follow a lead to Cuba. Together they manage to find the satellite dish, and the two plan to sabotage the base. Natalia is able to change the access codes before the two are taken hostage. In a tense moment, the two are able to break free. Natalia goes after the satellites while Bond takes on Trevelyan, and it's mano a mano. Bond takes out Trevelyan, and it's Natalia to the rescue. And the two are brought into Guantanamo for a thorough debriefing. Written by Michael France, Jeffrey Kane, and Bruce Feierstein, 1995's Goldeneye.
Yes. Now we're in the a whole new era here. 6 years after License to Kill, and a bunch of legal battles and mumbo jumbo. Finally, James Bond was back. If you thought the wait was long between Spectre and No Time to Die, this was even longer.
Probably not by a lot, though.
But not by much, really. When you get
But yeah, I mean, it's this. First of all, I kind of can't believe we're here already, because I feel like
I know.
We blew through this whole series and already we're talking about the James Bond right before the current James Bond.
Yes.
And yeah, this was.
Say right out of the gate, he's a great James. Pierce Brosnan is a great James Bond.
Yeah. Yes, he is, and I think we talked before when we were talking about Dalton, and I said, I was so relieved that they got Timothy Dalton instead of... I feel like the wait was good. Like, he was sort of well-served by having him wait a little longer.
Yes.
By not getting him when he was, like, fresh out of Remington Steel, I think it was a great move.
I think he was a little too boyish at that point, still.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Even here, like, if you notice in all the photos, He's got a little scruff, like just a tiny little bit of scruff, and I think that was their way of trying to kind of masculine him up a little bit, because without that he is very boyish looking.
You know, he did beef up for the next film, Tomorrow Never Dies. He gained some muscle mass for sure between Goldeneye mm-hmm. and Tomorrow Never Dies for sure.
Yeah. He's a little on the skinny side here, but fine, works.
Yeah, it does.
He's born to wear suits. Like, he really looks good in his suit.
Yeah, sure does.
Yeah. So he's a good James Bond, and we had mentioned before, we talked a couple times during this whole series, how every so often you can feel the kind of leap forward in time. Well, needless to say, this one is a literal leap forward in time. It's a big gap, and I think you really feel it. Like, you definitely feel the difference in how they shoot a film, frankly.
No, absolutely. You do feel so. The only thing that feels a little warmed over, I think, is, I hate to say this, but it's kind of the screenplay a little bit. Mm-hmm. There's a lot. Like, I think once you and I talked about this one time, this is sort of like a greatest hits in a way.
Yes.
And it's, not to spoil things or to give away things, but when I first went into this, I was looking forward to this one, to rewatch it. I probably haven't seen it since like 2012. So when that 50 set came out, and I was thinking, this is the higher echelon Bond. And I got to say, it went down a little bit for me this time. And I was disappointed by that. It's more, what it is? I think in this era, okay, of Brosnan, they mistake witty dialogue for characterization. And I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting. All right. That could be something, because I totally feel you that this is a weird one for me. And frankly, as long as I've sort of had to simmer with this film, I mean, for many, many years, I've thought about it. And I can't quite put my finger on what's missing in it. Because, like you said, it feels like
greatest hits. I had that feeling too when I was watching it this time.
It's like I can't get into the meat of it. And oddly, it's directed by Martin Campbell. And I've always said about Martin Campbell, he's a director who twice has had to come in and kind of rejuvenate the series.
Yeah,
bring it back to life.
If he just directed James Bond movies from here on out, no complaints from me.
He's great. Yeah. But it's interesting to me how Casino Royale, again, it's a great James Bond movie, but it has a very different feel than this one. And this one here, I can't quite put my finger on why I kind of can't get my hooks into it. I enjoy it just fine. Visually, it's good. There are certain complaints I have that are kind of more nitpicky than full-blown complaints. But for some reason, even though they sort of hit all the marks, they check all the boxes, for some reason, this one doesn't really grab me.
I know it's a favorite of many. Some people, like a lot of people, I think a lot of the generation now, this was like their first James Bond movie. And, because it was like that gap. And then all of a sudden it was like, what's this James Bond thing that everybody talks about,
And plus you had the video game. The video game was huge.
Oh, yeah, which was terrific. It's one of the few games where I finished from the get-go, Because most of the games I'll play a little bit. Oh, this is fun. And then I kind of forget about it. This is one game where I was dedicated to finishing the whole thing from start to finish. Yeah. At different levels, I might add.
that was probably one of the greatest video games of all time, frankly.
Terrific.
The multiplayer on Goldeneye was awesome. My brothers, cousins, we played that sucker forever.
Those were the days we had to get together, though, and you had the split screen.
Right.
And you could sort of cheat and see, he's in that room,
Right, totally. Yeah. Oh, my God. I would play with people all the time. Like if you played with a newbie, they're like, how did you find me in here? You're like, because I memorized the whole thing. I could see where you were.
I can't remember if it was Perfect Dark or Goldeneye where you had that gun that you could throw up on a wall and it was automated and it sensed when somebody came in the room and then
I had like a time mine. You had like rocket launches and grenades and all kinds of stuff. I think you had like a I totally yeah yeah, yeah.
It was just crazy. Great. It was lots of fun.
Oh, my gosh.
But no, what a great game. I mean, it was one of those games. It got me back in it because I had kind of left gaming. I was just kind of like, well, I'm doing this other thing now.
And it's interesting because, like, a lot of it's probably the first time that a literal generation of Bond fans sort of came to be because of a video game and not necessarily the movie.
Absolutely. You know, like, yeah, they never quite hit it. They never quite hit that high watermark again with the Bond games, though. Unfortunately, some of them are very good and interesting, but nothing quite matches that Goldeneye experience.
All right, so let's talk about it again. Like I said, it's a weird one for me because I feel like it's kind of a mystery. Like I can't quite figure out what is missing. The pre-titles is a mixed bag because it's got that magnificent bungee jump, you know, like
by the way, I have to toot your horn. Yeah, our own head of section here has done.
This is true. This
you
is
actually
true.
Made that jump from that actual dam.
Yep, certainly did.
Wow.
It's a place you can go to, and if you want to do it, you can do it.
Bond right there.
There you go. So it's weird to me that they start off with that great practical stunt, and then you go through the pre-titles, and then they finish off with the other stunt, which is not so practical.
Oh, is that the one where he jumps off the motorcycle?
Motorcycles off the
And that has a weird effect. It's like this weird thing where it's like just doesn't look good.
Yeah. Well, it's weird how when the motorcycle goes off, he jumps off and you see him sort of glide on an angle because the plane is going, you know, way far away. So it's like, it doesn't really work. And then it's like, how high was this mountain? First of all, you bungee jump way the hell down to this point. Now you're going to jump off another cliff to
That's a good point. I never thought of that.
You know?
It's like, damn you and your analytical mind.
Yeah, I tell you, right? I'm the king of ruining these movies, aren't I?
Oh, my God.
But the pre-title itself is interesting. Again, we meet Sean Bean, who is his partner.
Yeah, he's terrific.
Yeah, he was another guy. I mean, he was a great addition to the franchise.
He's gone on to have a great career, too. What a terrific actor he is.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And I like the pre-titles. I like the introduction of Orimov. I like how that all works. And, you know, the setup for what will happen later, that 006 will be the one who betrays James Bond. So, I mean, that's all working, you know. But, again, it has a sort of a clunky finale. But
you know what I think? I think it's weird with this film. The tone of it is a little odd, I think, because you have all these double entendres and these jokes, you know, on a top and all that stuff. And that's fine. I mean, it's kind of like, well, we're not taking this too seriously, you know, You know, our tongue is planted firmly in cheek. And then there's scenes where they're like, well, we want you to take this scene seriously. You know, like I'm thinking about when he's on the beach and he's thinking about...
Right.
She comes over to him and so forth. And he's all kind of a little depressed almost.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, I'm supposed to take this seriously now, you know?
It's
kind of like, try to have your cake and eat it too, you know?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think you could sort of make that case for a lot of the Bond films where they try to have like a serious moment and stuff.
I just think that this tone for the comedy, I mean, people complain about the Roger Moore era, but that's kind of restrained. I mean, yeah, the Roger Moore era reaches the high watermarks, you know, with the double-taking pigeons and Tarzan yells and so forth.
Yeah.
But this is, I mean, most of these scenes are played for laughs, to be honest with you.
I guess so. Yeah. I guess that kind of goes to what you're saying about like witty banter does not equal characterization.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe that is part of it. Yeah. I guess. You know who jumps out at me is like the Zukovsky character. Who I think works really well here.
He does. I mean, and I was kind of surprised. I was like, oh yeah, he's really only in that one scene. He's got like a scene and a half. You know, but he's a very memorable character though.
Yeah. No, he is. And I like how he's played. And honestly, like, they play that pretty well where he's kind of played for laughs. I mean, they literally got a full-blown comedian to play this part. Yeah. So you know he's meant to be, you know, a light moment in the film. I think he's played more seriously here. See, like, I don't like him later, but we'll talk about that when we get to it. Again, I kind of feel like they kept his character in tone okay. They never get carried away with him. So, but again, it's like, I can see where you're saying, like I can't find the right tone here, though. I'm not sure how to feel about it.
Don't get me wrong. This is very enjoyable to sit down and watch. Mm. You know, you have to understand, you and I are sitting down here, and we're being very analytical about the thing.
Yeah, yeah.
It's very enjoyable. I'd say the score is kind of a hit and miss. I mean, there's some parts of the score which are fine, and there's other parts of the score where it's actually distracting how bad it is. It's not fitting.
Which, yes.
With Eric Serra, I you know, that's a thing. When I heard he was going to compose the score, I was kind of excited because he had, I knew of his work with Luc Besson, you know, with La Femme Nikita and The Professional, a.k.a. Leon. Those are great scores. I mean, I have them. I own them. Yeah. And they're terrific, but for there's some reason. But I'm just speculating here, but I think it has to do with, I think Eric Serra looks at character, and that's how he sort of gets the score. And I think when if he doesn't have rich characters to pull from for the score to be inspired by, I think he kind of winds up with this. You know, that whole, you know, that chasing music, that wow, 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 wow.
Yeah.
Which is terrible. I mean, I sat there on opening. I went to Radio City Music Hall, saw this at the premiere. And I'm sitting there, and then, you know, the title song is great, you know, sung by Tina Turner and everything. And then that scene opens, and then you hear that first music cue, and you go, what have they done? Oh, everything was fine. What
right,
did
right, yeah.
Do? You
know? Yeah, no, that's so true. Because like when he's sneaking around in the facility, in the pre-titles, and you got like that dun dun, you know that.
That's fine. Yeah, that's great.
Bassy, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I mean it's all good stuff.
It's electronic. It's a little different, but that's okay. It was working. It was fine. You know.
You're absolutely right. And then all of a sudden he goes off on this really kind of wacky, bouncy, you know, tangent, and it's like, oh boy, what is that about? We've talked about this before, and I swear I would love to see somebody go back as an experiment and rescore this film with all the David Arnold tracks in the other movies.
It's not bad. You know? Yeah. You know what would be really cool? It would be even better, more of a treat if we just sat David Arnold down and he just composed a new score for it.
There you go. You know? Well, if you can get somebody to do that, I'm on board.
Come on, with all these Bond fans, we can get that going. We got some crowdfunder thing going. Let's do it.
That's an interesting idea.
We'll have them take a look at Never Say Never Again, too.
There you go. How about the characters and the people in it? Because I have kind of mixed feelings there, too.
I actually, you know, the characters are, how can I say it? They're a bit cartoonish, like Wade, the John Doe Baker character.
Right.
Everybody's a little bit cartoonish, you know?
Yeah.
That's what I was trying to think of. Alan Cumming. It's a fun character, but again, it's very cartoonish. Even Famke Janssen, who's great, you know, on the top.
There are a lot of characters to sort of keep track of in this, you know?
There are.
You have, you know, we were talking about in The Living Daylights, you had three bad guys to kind of combine to make one big one, I suppose. You actually have four here. You have Trevelyan, you have Oromov, you have Onatopp, and then you have Boris. It's like that's four people now that we're trying to keep track of. And these are not even like It's not even like you know, Goldfinger and Oddjob is the henchman. I mean, you have a full blown kind of quartet going on.
Yeah,
here.
No, it's true. How, you know, I'm always kind of tripping over this Isabella as a Scorpio.
Scorupo? Yeah, I'm not Scorupo. Sure either. I ruined that too.
Scorupo. Please forgive me. But oh my God, she's gorgeous. And she plays the character of Natalia. You know, I got from a distance, I saw at the premiere, and her and Famke Janssen were together, and I was just like, oh my God, these girls are gorgeous, unbelievable, beautiful.
I've always sort of remembered her as being like the one time I can remember in Bond history where you had a stunning actress who they kind of like toned her down a bit to be almost frumpy.
I've read some interviews with her where she's sort of like saying, can I get something a little sexier? I mean, she was into it, you know, she wanted to have it. And they're kind of like, nah, you know, and it's like, you know, he's like, Martin, I love you, Mr. Campbell, but I want to slap you in the face. What are you doing?
Right. Oh, my God.
Girl, come on.
I mean, and I kind of get it that she's supposed to be sort of like a Joe Everyman kind of a thing. Like she's a regular person who works a regular job. All right, yeah, I get that, but and frankly, I sort of feel like that Severnaya scene. I feel like that takes up half the movie. I feel like that just goes on and on. I can remember looking through like the DVD or even the Laserdisc, and I felt like it would be like 7-8 chapters would happen in that scene. You know?
Yeah. By the way, that was like probably when it came to Laserdisc, that was like sort of like the top tier Laserdisc, you know.
It was
kind of like that's when that technology and everything and that film kind of met, and it was like everything was great. And that was also like they had a plethora of extras on that Laserdisc,
I think it was the only disc I actually had that had a really nice cover. Because the other ones, they would like all the oldies, they would take it, they'd slap a picture on it, put the logo on it, whatever.
This one,
it was current, so the
has a gatefold and everything.
Yeah.
It's really nice.
So anyway, but she's fine in the role, but I kind of feel like it's a very thankless role. She doesn't get much to do.
I think she does a great job. I think she's a really good actress. It's kind of a shame that there's not more meat on that role. Yeah. You know?
Yeah. Well, you know, actually, as I was saying the words, it shouldn't have much to do. I was sort of thinking, well, that's not exactly true. I mean, they do give her things to do. But, well, first of all, you're right. I mean, I feel like she's in that sweater for half the movie. You know what I mean?
I know.
Again, it is just what the role is. I mean, and this is one of those films, like, it doesn't, you know, some films seem to happen over the course of 48 hours, and some are much longer in scope where they take, like, a week or longer to finish the story.
Yes.
In the time of the film, I mean. This one is one of those, like, it's like a 48-hour thing and it's done. So, the fact that she sort of got stuck in that skirt and the sweater, that's it. Tough nookies, you know?
Even when they had a chance to, like, when they finally get to that beach scene and they're on there.
Yeah.
And it's sort of like, it's kind of revealing, but I don't know if I found the right word, but it's like, It's okay, you know? It's just like, it's not what I wanted. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, this kind of ushers in that era of Brosnan films. You know, one of the things about the Brosnans that always kind of bothered me is that it's so focused on keeping the story moving forward and not taking 5 minutes to sort of sit back and relax and enjoy themselves. I mean, I guess that's not totally true because, I mean, you get that great scene in M's office when they're talking, and even the scene later with Robbie Coltrane and Zukovsky. There are some sit down, just chatting for a second
moments. And those are like the best scenes in the film.
Yeah, honestly. But again, I kind of feel like they're kind of too far, you know, too far in between or whatever. That scene on the beach, like you get. Like it cuts right from the conversation with Jack Wade, right? And it sort of hangs on her. Then it cuts to Bond sitting on the beach, and she walks over, and you don't really even see her like head to toe. Like you see her like from the waist down or something, sort of walking toward the camera. Mm-hmm. It's a nice shot, but you don't. I mean, you think like we got this gorgeous woman on a beach in a bikini. Finally, how about like one good shot of her standing there looking like wow, you know, because again, I mean, she in real life is stunning, but they kind of sort of move
Why can't you pay a little tribute? Have her walking out of the ocean.
Right.
Why not? Come on.
But even if it's not that, even if we don't get that, just something where you get like a good look at her or something, a moment to sort of just take it all in. But it just seems like, well, we need to get this done so we can get moving to the next thing and whatever. And it just feels like, and then they cut from that. Like, you know, then Bond does that one, you know, that move where, like, oh, she's cranky, so I'll just plant one on her, and that'll make everything better. And then they cut to the scene.
In real life, by the way.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think I want to find out. But... but then they cut to the scene where they're in bed together, and it's like just one or two lines of dialogue, and then we move on to the next thing. And I mean, it gets worse in the next film.
Oh yeah, just gonna say this is like a model of restraint compared to the next film.
Yeah. But you see it starting. You see the seeds planted where it's like they seem to be in a big hurry, and it's like, and it's almost like they think that nobody's got the attention spans they used to, so we got to keep
wrong.
Yes and no.
Yeah.
But it's frustrating when you're watching it. Yes. It's like, all right, slow down for a second. I want to just see something. Like, it's just all the really good scenes, they're over too quick.
What? No small talk? No chit chat? That's the trouble with the world today. No one takes the time to do a really sinister interrogation anymore. It's a lost art.
Yeah.
I mean, that was a great moment. Yeah. You know, like, I like that. I like that back and forth. But and then she says, you know, stop it. It was this guy. And then Orma bursts in. So I feel like it's like I like what I'm getting, but I'm getting short bursts of it, and it's just over too quick.
Very true. Very true. I mean, I hate to say it because it really was an important film. It did very well. Mm. It was, you know, audiences really loved it.
Mm.
And I did too. I had a great time with it. I just felt, you're right, that we're in a new era now, and it feels like we lost a little something, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, even as I'm reading off the writers, I'm saying to myself, like I feel like the last, I don't know how many films, it was like, you know, written by Michael G. Wilson and Richard Maybaum. I feel like I must have said that like 10 times in a row as I'm introducing the thing. And now suddenly I have all these names that's wildly different, you know? So it's like, we're kind of in the era now where we have a new crew trying to figure out what makes a James Bond movie tick.
That's right.
You know, and how can we replicate that? And again, I feel like as we go through these Brosnan films, it's going to be a lot of, well, this didn't work, and then later they sort of fixed this, but that wasn't working.
Right.
And then we fixed that, and then this wasn't working. So Brosnan really never gets a great film.
That's what I was going to say. He's a great James Bond in search of a great script.
A lot of what bothers me about this film, when I get down to nitpicks, a lot of the things that bother me have something to do with audio. It's something you're hearing that I don't quite like. We talked about the score. I mean, that's kind of a given. A lot of the sound effects don't work for me, which is odd, which is a very odd complaint. Yeah. Even like just the explosions, they don't have that kind of kablam punch. They just—they're more like these crackling, rumbling, and again, like an odd thing. But just after time, I sort of picked up on it.
Right.
But the other thing that bothers me too is Brosnan's delivery.
The name's Bond. James Bond.
He's good as Bond, but in this one, he decided to do this kind of whispery, throaty, mousy voice, and that drives me nuts. He's
really?
Whispering. Yeah. I mean, even when he says like the line, like he says, the name is Bond, James Bond. And he pauses and it's a very quiet James Bond. And I'm like, wait, no, say it. Like, just say it right. Like he'll do it again in other films. Like, in fact, seriously, Dying of the Day, the one thing I really like, and he says, you know,
my friends call me James Bond.
My friends call me, and he goes, my friends call me James Bond, which is a reference back to,
my friends call me Tanya.
Mine call me James Bond.
From Rush with Love,
yeah,
which is great, you know. But here, yeah, just James Bond. And I really can't stand that quiet, whispery thing he's doing there.
That doesn't bother me, actually. I think that's fine. You know, you
really?
Just put your stamp on it. I don't have an issue with that. That's interesting you bring that up. I just never had a problem with that.
I appreciate he is putting his own stamp on it, and that part I appreciate just fine. But I just I'm not saying you got to be Sean Connery, but speak up. You're James Bond, you know? Like don't whisper and apologize for saying your name.
Look at you, bitch slapping James Bond over there.
Look, I mean, Goldeneye is a fine movie. It's. I mean, seriously, it's. I'll like spoiler alert. It's not going to get below a 5 for me. It's not. I'm not trying to say it's a bad film. But I feel like for a film as good as this one is, for all the things it's doing right, it's hitting all the marks. But so it's up there. But just not great. Like, it's not one of those ones that I can watch a lot. You know
what
I mean?
That's what I was going to say. You know, I'm so familiar with the early Bond, especially the Connery ones and the Moore ones. Mm. And even the Daniel Craig stuff. I mean, like Casino, Skyfall. But I have to say, this era, I was like really into it, you know, in the 90s and stuff for the most part. But yeah, there's something like over the years, it's not these are not the ones I reach for, you know?
Right, yeah. And there was always sort of not so much in Goldeneye, but I think maybe later I feel like there was always like in the 90s, like if you took a date to see, like, you know, like in Fletch, he says, I always take my first dates to a Laker game. Right. Like back in the 90s, I would always take my dates to see a James Bond movie. If there was a James Bond movie out, like, I would take a date to see it. And you, like, for the most part, it would be pretty cool. And then it'd be like one scene in there where you're kind of going, oh, just forget, just pretend that didn't happen. You know, like, there's always one part where it kind of dips. And like, Goldeneye doesn't really have that. But on the other hand, it was still not quite one I could really get excited about.
Right.
You know, I mean, I do remember, again, Brosnan looks great. Everything he's wearing was great. And that was like, I remember like if you were doing like job interviews and you had to get a suit, you'd pop on Goldeneye and you'd look and see what Brosnan was wearing. Yeah, and you would try to get the exact same suit or, you know, try to do, like, I think the first time I ever like wore a pocket square was after Goldeneye, you know. It's a good looking movie, you know. I mean, they're drinking whiskey and having good conversations.
You can't fault a movie that has a casino scene, you know.
At least it's got that right. Seriously, yeah. Got like I can't remember last time we even had one of those. Well, Casino Royale. That's a little frustrating. Yeah, I mean, yeah, they're doing that right. I mean, it's good. And again, seriously, I mean, and I remember you couldn't fault the film for its writing because they had all those great. Like, again, like Judi Dench has got the great lines about being a sexist, misogynist dinosaur.
That's a good scene. I mean,
it's a great scene. Yeah. It's a great scene.
I think the thing with Moneypenny might be a little too much, but yeah, it is what it is. Whatever.
Well, yeah, that's the whole different thing we'll talk about. But even the scene, like, you know, when Trevelyan has the line about did all the martinis, you know, get rid of all the screaming women or something, rather, I'm going to ruin that one.
Oh, please, James, spare me the Freud. I might as well ask you if all the vodka martinis ever silenced the screams of all the men you've killed. Yeah. What if you find forgiveness in the arms of all those willing women for all the dead ones you failed to protect?
I mean, that's good stuff. It's really good stuff. So again, it just
I think it's good stuff. I don't know if it belongs with the tone of this film, though. Mm. I know that they're trying to shoehorn that part of it in. I don't know if it works, though, because you're kind of having this, you'd have like whole scenes with, you know, with all this just kind of double entendre dialogue and stuff. And then you do that. I don't know. It just didn't quite gel for me. I don't know.
I don't find the double entendres bad in this one. I mean, it gets really bad.
Oh, but that ain't another day. Road. It's out of control.
I have been known to keep my tip up.
That tank scene is really good. I guess for an action scene, I mean, it's spectacular in every way.
Yeah,
That was, you know, if they didn't have that big scene right there, I don't know. Yeah, this would be kind of you know. It's a really good action scene.
It's a very good action scene, but you bring up a good point because it's kind of one of the only action scenes, frankly. And there's really not a lot of big action set pieces in this. Like some of them later, I especially like The World's Not Enough, all this action pieces seem kind of wedged in there, but there's a lot of them. Here, I kind of feel like as far as just a full blown action scene, that's kind of almost it, really. I mean, you get the stunt in the pre-titles, everything else is kind of like talking a little. I mean, things happen, Like, I mean, the part when they're in the helicopter that's about to blow up. I mean, but I wouldn't call it an action scene. You know, I mean, and there's good. There's running around, you know, when they're escaping. There's a lot of machine gun fighting.
That's part of the tank scene.
It's sort of the lead up to the tank chase. Yeah. I mean, honestly, there's not a lot of just full-blown action sequences in this.
You know what, though? And not really an action scene, but I really love that graveyard scene when he first, you know, 009 is revealed and you have all those relics of the Cold War, all those statues and everything. That's just like a great idea, I think.
And I agree. You know, that is it's a good setting. And again, that sort of fits in with the titles, by the way. By the way, we have a new somebody now doing the titles that are different.
Daniel Kleinman, right?
Kleinman's first, and he's great. He's very good, and I feel like he's been a tribute to the franchise since he got on board.
And that's the thing. I really love the title song, and that was one of the disappointments of the score for me. I wish they had put more instrumentals of that in there, and I wish the movie had more of a backbone with that score. You know, too bad. I gotta say, Famke Janssen is great in this, though. She's the one that kind of, like, you know, all her little jokes kind of. She's the one that really sells it, I think, in this film.
Yeah, she doesn't really do it for me, to tell you the truth. I'm
lifting my jaw off the floor right now and putting it back.
Well, you know what it is. I kind of put it this. It always rubs me a little funny when they get an American actress to play a foreign part. She's fun. It much better.
Really?
She's okay.
You think it's a little too Boris and Natasha?
Yes. Okay. Yes. Right. That's a great way to say it. Yeah. She's a little, I kind of feel like, you know, she's got that, I'm Russian and I will talk like this. And I don't know. She's kind of, I like the idea of her, you know, and I should stop. You know, I feel like I'm just kind of like digging myself a bigger hole. I know a lot of people like her. She's a great character. But I think
to be honest with you, for me, I think the movie not runs out of steam, but when she's dispatched by that helicopter.
I mean, it's a good scene, and you're absolutely right. I think when she's gone, it does sort of take a little bit of like, oh, well, now she's gone. So now what's left? I'll just sort of say, like, her accent comes in and out a lot, and then that kind of, I notice it a little too much.
I think that, but she's so on point though, as far as like she's there as the character, you know, and she's gone on to another one that's gone on to a great career. She's a terrific actress, and it was great that this is like one of her first, you know, major roles. So,
yeah.
And you know what I do like in this film is I did like the tension with when Boris gets that pen that Q has given Bond, that if he clicks arms the fuse thing.
Yes,
at the end where he keeps clicking it and Rosin's
and you as the audience, you're trying to you're trying to sort of keep up with it, and you're like, oh, I don't know where we are either. Yeah.
And they get the Brosnan looking at it, and he's just like, you know, he got this pain look on his face.
Yes.
That's a terrific sequence. See, you don't need to spend $100 million on exploding shit, pardon my French. If you just create something like that, it's just as good. It's just as entertaining.
Yes, I'm with you. And I've said it before. I feel like, you know, they don't put a lot of tension into films anymore.
It's one
just kind of one explosion after another. We got to keep. I mean, like, yeah.
That's the problem I have with later. What's going to happen in Tomorrow Never Dies, and then later on with Quantum. Pace is everything. It's everything for the film. Everything is sacrificed for the pacing. And when you do that, you lose a lot of other stuff. And that's unfortunate. Yeah.
Yes, I could not agree more. Yes. Yeah, you're right. I think that could be very much part of the problem I have with all of the Brosnans, you know, and this one too. They're in such a hurry to get to the next thing. It's like watching somebody like just changing channels. We'll just pick something and hold still. You know, they're in such a hurry to get to the next thing. It's like, well, can I just enjoy this for now? It's low attention span theater, and I find it very frustrating.
I know maybe this is not the right film to be bringing this all up. You know, because it's not that you know, like this. But I know.
It doesn't get that bad with this one, but it's. Right. I feel like you see it start here. Like this is the scene, and it just gets worse later.
Well, it shows you like what happened to the pace of cinema from 1989 up until this point. And there was like a quantum leap, really, you know, because I think by this time, I'm not 100%, but I think Michael Bay had sort of arrived on the scene and he might have done like The Rock by this point or just about to. So like that type of cinema was about to begin, you know?
Yeah. Yes. Right. It's kind of getting to where they're too focused on spectacle and they really and just don't. Yeah. Right. It's all quickly paced. You're right. There's no such thing as easy pace.
To me, if you take the time to develop characters and get to characters where I feel something for them emotionally, and then you put that character in danger, that's 10 times the suspense, 10 times the excitement, because I have an investment in the characters now. Because I've made an emotional connection.
Right.
And when you don't bother with that, you're like, all that stuff. Let's get to the highlight reel.
Yeah.
There's no stakes. There's no jeopardy. It's just you're looking at pretty images on a screen. You know?
Yeah. Well, you know, the ironic part, too, is I think what you're talking about, I think they tried very hard to do that with Natalia's character. They tried very hard to let you get to know her a little bit. So that when she was in jeopardy, you could feel something, and in that respect, I think that works. But again, I feel like that whole scene there takes forever. So was that the correct use of that time? I mean, there's a lot of screen time dedicated to that location. I feel like that whole Severn Iyer thing. I mean, and constantly cutting back and forth. You got Bond and Tanner and M. at HQ. I mean, seriously, from the time you meet Moneypenny, right? I mean, Bond shows up, Moneypenny greets him as he gets there. There's a banter there. From the time that he has the M scene where she calls him the sexiest dinosaur and that's a big gap of the film. And they keep, and that's the whole thing where they're cutting back and forth to Severn Iyer, etc. So it's like, boy, that seems to take forever.
Oh, I have to talk about something here too. The Q scene here. I love Desmond Llewellyn. I always will. But it's so obvious in this Q scene, he's reading off cue cards. It's really bad. Have you noticed?
Yeah.
Really bad in this one. It's not good. It's like he's in a Saturday Night Live skit. It's like, wow. You know?
Right. Yeah. And it's interesting because I think they kind of corrected that later. I think they sort of realized, well, you have to sort of play him like when they sort of corrected that in Tomorrow Never Dies he's got the rental jacket on.
Oh, I hate that rental jacket. I understand he's with Avis, but come on. That's the worst mistake putting him in there. That's terrible. I'm sorry. But go ahead.
We're in the days of product placement.
Yeah,
now.
Yeah.
So here's something we could talk about if we want. With all the people complaining that the No Time to Die trailer looks woke, which I kind of feel like, hey, have you seen Goldeneye?
I know, right? I was watching this. It's like that Moneypenny scene when he meets Moneypenny. It's almost like a wet blanket. It's like, oh, that party's over, I guess.
You
better get on board, mister.
Right.
You know?
Oh, my God. It's so funny. Tomorrow, the No Time to Die is coming. Everybody's, Phoebe Waller-Bridge and all this other stuff. And I'm like, all right, yeah, I get why you're concerned. I do. And then the trailer came out, and I was like, all right, that's fine. And then I heard like just a few people left, kind of going like, oh, the part where she threatens to shoot him in the knee, whatever. That's all.
I might have said that myself.
Yeah. But honestly, I kind of felt like, have you seen Goldeneye?
No, like, it's
literally riddled with. I mean, you have the conversation with M. M calls him a sexist dinosaur.
Yes.
And it's not just that she says that. He goes, point taken. He goes, not quite. And again, kind of leaves him like.
Yeah, he gets hoisted on his petard more than once here.
Seriously, you got Moneypenny calling him out, and then you have the Natalia character.
But don't stand there. Get us out of here.
Yes, sir.
He's like constantly wagging his
head. No, again,
I mean, like, some of it I have problems with. Some of it I don't. But seriously, I feel like if you want to argue that there was a woke, there, like, if you're going to tell me this is the first time you ever saw this, look at this one. This one
no, is it's right.
And again, it's frustrating because I sort of feel like there is a blatant attempt to sort of make Brosnan look like he doesn't know what to do with himself. Like he's sitting there kind of like dumbfounded. Whoops. You know, like, I don't know what to.
I'm sorry, buddy. My light went out.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
Okay. Hold on one second. Should I stop recording?
No, it's all right. Things happen. Yeah, we were kind of right at the 50-minute mark, so we could probably start doing the scores.
Okay, that was good, man. We're on a good run there. But I think I think the point was made. So I really like this film, and I would love to give it a high score. I went in kind of thinking, because I had fond memories of the film. I really did. But I always had like these little nigging little things that I knew that didn't quite work, that they were attempted but didn't work. I really like the cast, and I think Martin Campbell's a good director, although he does sometimes have a problem a little bit with his lulls, sometimes. Going into this, I was thinking of giving this, I was thinking, man, this is probably like an 8 or a 9, but I was starting to think, ooh, maybe it's more like a 7. But there's just too many things in here that are really a lot of fun, the tank chase, the opening credits. And Pierce Brosnan himself, who makes a terrific Bond. He really is. He's great in the role. I love the supporting cast, like I've said before. So I think I'm going to go, you know what? This is like sort of the greatest hits Bond and everything, but I'm going to go with an 8. This is like a solid movie. It's a lot of fun. It's not the crest, though. It's not in the upper echelon for me, but it's just kind of touching the tip there. So it's like 8.
I can totally see that. I'm kind of with you when you were at a 7. 7 is my number, and again, it's not. It's a solid film. It's definitely in the upper echelon, you know. But again, for the reasons we said, just can't quite get it. It's just too. There's that greatest hits feel to it, and there's something, it's kind of just out of my reach, right? Just kind of can't really wrap my arms around it and get too absorbed in it. It's something I watch. It's like the screenplay is good. The banter, the dialogue is good. I enjoy watching it for what it is. But it's not like a world I can jump into and really kind of get absorbed in. And again, it just sort of leaves me sitting here feeling a little dumb that I can't quite put my finger on what's missing about it. But again, it's a fine piece of film. Brosnan's good. So I think 7 is where I'm settling.
I'm going to jump right in here and claim that opening car music. Please, no. And I like Eric Serra as a composer for the most part. I really do. I just don't think maybe this James Bond world is really his strength, you know? It's not really for him. He's better with movies that have like different, more kind of wilder characterizations that he can sort of take from and use to compose his score. So yeah, it's that crazy, terrible cue from the opening car scene. Did I steal yours?
Yeah, I think anybody watching this is that thinking the same thing.
That's why I like to go first. I'm greedy. I have to pick the low hanging fruit. You know.
There you go. Yeah, I think I'm just gonna go with the plane stunt in the pre-titles. I feel like it's kind of a weak moment in an otherwise really good pre-title sequence. Again, you start off with a really good opening stunt, and then you go to something else which really looks fake, and it just kind of doesn't look right, because again, your brain is saying like, how high is this mountain already? I mean, even if you don't, you know, factor in the bungee jump, it's still like it takes the plane forever before it's, you know. So yeah, I guess that one.
I am going to go with that tank scene. It's kind of an easy shot, but I think that whole sequence is like, it's, I don't know, that's what the movie really is working for me. The, like, the lines are working, and that interrogation scene is pretty good right before it. That's like a good chunk of the movie with where everything's working on all cylinders. So, yeah, I really like, you know, the interrogation scene and then that diving into that tank scene. That's like my, I think, my favorite part of the film.
Mine's going to be a weird one, and I feel like I probably kind of sort of nitpicked about this before. So the fact that it's kind of my favorite part is going to sound weird. But I love the scene where Bond is creeping around on the boat in Monte Carlo.
Okay.
There's something about that. I think it's partially the location. It's partially what he's wearing. And there's kind of just something, that kind of sneaky Bond, stealthy thing that he's doing there. It kind of all works.
Even has a cool way of opening that sliding door.
You know? Yeah. Even the little fight he gets into with the guy there, he smacks him with the towel, then he dabs his face with it. I mean, that's great. That's kind of classic Bond. So, yeah, it's sort of a weird little kind of almost a nothing moment to make your favorite part, but honestly, I really like it. Oh, I was looking for that. Well, Scott, my friend, thank you as always. Another great show, and I'll see you next time.
All right, I look forward to it. I really do.
James Bond.